In this video, I'm going to give you 6 Gmail tips for teachers. I'll show you how to do things like set up templates to automate your emailing workflow, how to set up filters to clean up your inbox and organize emails into a clear labeling system, how to set up a custom signature for your email, how to customize your Gmail theme, and more. My name is Sam Carey, and this is my YouTube channel for the new EdTech Classroom. If you like the tips that I share in this video about how to optimize your email settings, you can show your appreciation by sharing it with other teachers that you know, hitting the like button, leaving a comment, and subscribing to my channel and hitting the notification bell to make sure you don't miss any of my weekly updates. All right, let's jump in and take a look at 6 Gmail tips for teachers. If you don't change any of the settings in Gmail, the default setting for your inbox is going to have it set up where it mixes all of your read and unread emails together. That might be okay if you don't get a lot of emails, but once you're in a situation where you have lots of different messages that you need to respond to, you're probably going to want to set up your inbox to look a little bit different to help you prioritize what you need to do first. So my first tip is that you change the inbox settings so that you only see unread emails first. The way that you're going to do that is by going up here to the settings cog, and then you'll scroll down and change the inbox type to unread first. Now you'll see after you change that setting that when you go to your inbox, it's going to have all your unread messages at the top and all of your read messages down below. This will help you prioritize and see all the messages that you still need to respond to. And I like to make a point of making sure that if I open an email, I'm either responding to it right away or I'm making sure that it stays unread so that it always stays in my unread section. And that way I know the emails that I still need to go through. I'm sure all of us have been in a situation where we've accidentally sent an email and then realized right away that we didn't actually want to send it or that there was something that we needed to fix. So my second tip is that you set up your email so that you have the longest period possible to cancel that email after it's been sent. So the way you're going to do that is by going back up to the settings cog, select see all settings, and then you'll want to make sure that you're on the general settings tab. Now you're going to scroll down to undo send and change the duration of time from 5 seconds to 30 seconds. After you've made that change, make sure you scroll all the way down to the bottom to click save changes so that that setting change goes into effect. So let's see what that looks like now that I've changed this setting. Let's say that I'm typing up an email here and I fire it off, but then I realize immediately after I sent it that I made a mistake and that I actually don't want that email to go out. Now I have a 30-second window to undo sending that message. And if I click undo, it's just going to pop back up my email draft so I can make any edits or changes that I need to before I send it out again. Having this function enabled for the longest period of time just gives me a little bit more peace of mind because I know that if I make a mistake, I still have some time to be able to fix it. My third tip is that you set up a signature that goes on the bottom of each of your emails so that you don't have to type that over and over again. To do this, we're going to go back up to the settings cog and we'll stay on the general tab again. And then I'm going to scroll all the way down to signature. Right now you can see that the default is that you don't have any signatures set up. So if you want to create one, go ahead and click create new. Then you'll give your signature a name. And this is just a name to identify the signature. It's not actually what's going to show up in the email. So I'll just call it my teacher signature here. So then what I'll do is type my name, my role, and the school where I teach or my organization. And you'll see that you can also customize the text. So I'm going to change the font here as well. You can also include links in your signature. So if you wanted to include a hyperlink out to another page, you could do that as well. Again, make sure you scroll down and click save changes in order for that change to go into effect. And now that I have that setting enabled, you'll notice that when I compose new emails, that teacher signature is at the bottom of all the new emails that I compose. My fourth tip is one of my absolute favorite features of Gmail, and that's to set up templates so that you can automate your responses. In order to do this, we're first going to need to enable the template feature. So I'll go back up to the settings cog And then I'm going to go all the way over to the Advanced tab. On the Advanced tab, you'll see that the default setting is that templates are disabled. So you're going to need to enable this setting in order to use them. So now that I have templates enabled, I'm going to go ahead here and compose a new message. So let's say that I have a common message that I write often to students about incomplete work. I could include the subject incomplete work and then the body of my email where I'm explaining generally what a student needs to do in order to figure out what work is incomplete, as well as how to make sure that it gets turned in. After I've written my email, I can go down here to the three dots on the bottom right-hand corner of the email and select templates. You'll see that I've actually already created some templates here as well, but since this is a brand new email that I want to set up as a template, I'm going to click Save Draft as Template. That will prompt me to enter a new template name, and you want to include a name here that you can easily remember and associate with what you wrote in that email so that you can use it over and over again. Okay, so now let's say that I'm writing a new student, basically the same exact message about their incomplete work. What I can do is pull up a new email to compose, and then rather than actually write that email, I'll go back down to the same three dots, select templates, and then I'll choose that same template that I just created. Here you'll see that the subject line and body of the email are all going to be automatically populated so that I don't actually have to rewrite that email. Of course, you can go back in and make small edits if you need to, but it's going to save you a lot of time because you don't have to rewrite out instructions when you've already done that. So let's look at another example here. Let's say that I have this other template, where to find assignments in Google Classroom. You can imagine that you might be writing these same kinds of instructions over and over again for students. And rather than rewriting them every single time, you just want to create an automated email with those same instructions included. So this template's already been made, but let's say that I want to edit it a little bit so that the next time I use the template, it has some additional information, or I just want to change something about the template. I'll go back down here to the three dots, and this time I'll select the name of that same template, and then I'll choose to overwrite the template that I created. So now every time I write an email and include the template where to find assignments in Google Classroom, it will have this updated version. Anytime you write an email that you think you might just repeat over and over again, I would recommend that you save it as a template so that you can use it in the future and even in future school years in order to save yourself some time. The fifth tip is to set up your filter and label system to clean up your inbox a little bit. If you selected to receive notifications from Google Classroom, you might find that you're getting a huge bomb of emails from Google Classroom on pretty much a daily basis. Since I know I get a lot of emails from Google Classroom and I want those to be better organized, I'm going to start by creating a label for Google Classroom. So on the menu on the left-hand side here on Gmail, I'm going to scroll down to Create New Label, and then I'm going to make a label called Google Classroom. Now the idea is that I want to set up my email so that emails that come from Google Classroom go straight into this labeling system so that I don't have them clutter up my email inbox. I could set this up so that all my Google Classroom emails just go under this single label, but since I know that I get lots of different types of emails from Google Classroom, I'm going to create a sub-categorization system in order to keep that work even better organized. So an email you might get a lot from Google Classroom is a notification letting you know that somebody left a comment. I definitely want to see these emails, but I also don't want them to clutter up my inbox. So what I'm going to do here is go back up to the settings cog, and then I'm going to go over to the filters tab. And what I want to do here is filter all the emails that are coming into my inbox that have anything to do with comments left in Google Classroom. So I'll go down here to has the words, and then I'll type Google Classroom commented. And what that's going to do is set up a filter so that Gmail will read any incoming email that comes through that has those three words, Google, Classroom, and commented. I'll select to create the filter, and then I'm going to select the box to have this email skip my inbox. So I'm going to create a new label here that says comments, but I don't want that to be a standalone label. I want that label to be categorized underneath the Google Classroom label that I already created. So I'm going to select the option here to nest the label, and then I'll select the parent label that I want this comments label to be nested under. And now you'll see that this comments label is going to be categorized under that broader category of Google Classroom emails. And then the last box that I'm going to check here is to apply this filter to previous matching conversations. So what selecting this option is going to do is go back and read all of my old emails and help me organize and categorize those emails under this label system as well. And once I'm ready, I'll click that blue Create Filter button. Now you'll notice back on the inbox that if I go down to my labels and select the comments label that's underneath the parent label, Google Classroom, I'll be able to see all the emails that have come through that have to do with somebody commenting in Google Classroom. You may find that you get emails that just have the word comment as opposed to commented. And if that's the case, you might need to set up a separate filter for those emails as well. Now, another type of common email you might get from Google Classroom is a submitted late email. So I'm going to do the same thing here and set up a filter that has the words Google Classroom and submitted late. I'll check the same boxes and make sure that that submitted late label is nested underneath the Google Classroom label. And then after I create the filter and go back to my inbox, you'll now notice that when I click on that new label, all of the emails that have to do with students turning in work late through Google Classroom are now subcategorized under that label. It is important to note that since I clicked that box for the emails not to come into my inbox, I'm not actually going to see them unless I proactively select this label. I like that because it helps me declutter my inbox, and then I can just make sure to check that label once a day so that I can see the new emails that came in under that particular category. Now, of course, this applies to emails other than Google Classroom emails. So if you have other types of emails that you receive regularly that you don't necessarily want to come into your inbox, that you just want to go into a label system, you can set that up as well. And you don't have to select the option for an email not to come to your inbox. So you could create the label, have it categorized under that label, but still have it show up in your inbox if that worked better for you. The last tip that I want to show you here is just how to customize your Gmail a little bit. So to do this, go back up to the settings and select the themes tab. And there you'll see that you have an option to set your theme. Your Gmail is likely just set to a default theme, but here you'll see that you could choose from lots of different images that you could include to be part of your theme for Gmail, or you could bring in your own pictures that are in your Google Photos. So I'll just select this one here, and now you'll see that my Gmail just has a more personalized custom look. I hope you found these tips about how to improve your teacher Gmail experience helpful. If you have any questions or other suggestions about how to improve Gmail for teachers, I'd love to hear about those in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching my video to the end. If you found the tips that I shared helpful, please share it with other teachers that you know, hit the like button, and subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell to make sure you don't miss any of my weekly updates. You can also check out some of the other tutorials I have on my channel by clicking on one of those two videos above. And if you're interested in downloading any of the resources that I've created and show on my videos, please visit my website at www.newedtechclassroom.com. Lastly, if you want to check me out on social media, my Twitter handle, Facebook page, and Pinterest account are all in the description below. Thanks so much and have a great week.